how many of you guys are sort of setting out to be journalists? I mean, you are mostly a... Great, that's fantastic. It's always nice to meet people who actually want to be journalists and not addressing a class of people who are forced to study journalism. You know, I thought what we'll talk about today is, I'm not sure how many of you specifically may want to be entertainment journalists. Maybe not. I mean, I think you're also at that age where you will still decide where you want to specialize in, right? So I thought what's key to journalism, irrespective of what journalism you ultimately pursue, is interviewing. I thought we'll talk a little about interviewing, because I think that is something that's key to any, whether you decide to become a news reporter, whether you become a, you know, a features reporter, a film journalist, a sports journalist, any form of journalism, the key to all journalism is interviewing, because interviewing can be done as it can be a part of reporting, it can be a part of actually sitting down and do a, you know, two camera interview as you do with, you know, as you, I'm talking about, I will very often end up talking about television, but please, please jump in and ask me how it works in print. I have worked in print, so I might be able to, I will be able to shed some light. Things you need to keep in mind when you're interviewing someone. Now, first of all, why would you be interviewing someone? You'd be interviewing someone because they are in the news for some reason, right? You'd interview someone because, you'd interview a sportsman because he's just delivered his 100th. You know, you'd interview Sachin Tendulkar because he's just given his, it's his 100th century. You'd interview Shah Rukh Khan because he's just won a Filmfare Award. You'd interview, you know, a minister because he's either in a scam or he's helped solve a scam. I mean, there's a, the basic thing about interviewing is that there has to be a reason. There has to be a news peg to interviewing someone. There has to be a reason. And sometimes, as you will find in the real world, you'll be sent out to interview someone and there may not really be a reason, you know. I mean, you, say you work in Delhi and you know, and I don't know, Guns N' Roses is in Delhi, but there's no real reason to interview them. I mean, it's not like they've just come out with a new album or whatever. I'm saying Guns N' Roses, at least that's your news peg already, that, you know, they've come to Delhi. But I'm saying you might have to, you have to find the news peg. You have to find a reason, at least when you're communicating that interview, at least when you're writing that interview or when you're conducting that interview on television, the person who's watching it needs to know, why are you doing this interview? So you have to find within that conversation, within that interview of yours, the one factor that makes it newsworthy, there should be a reason why you're interviewing that person. And you will find that out, A, in your research, which is the key. When I was talking about what are the key, the salient features, the most important things about interview, research. You can't go for an interview, and I find this is one of the, you know, we have a lot of younger, we have a lot of interns, we have a lot of college students who come and work with us. One of the problems is that no one researches. You can't go for an interview without knowing, without preparing for that interview. Preparation, research is the first thing. You know, I come from a time when there was no internet. I mean, I was a journalist when I was 16. So at that time, there was no internet. So half your research really came from going to libraries, looking at back issues of newspapers. Today you have what? Google. I mean, it makes half your life, not even half, it makes 99% of your job done. Of course you have to, but remember that Google is also man-made. It's not some god's, you know, carved in stone. So while Googling is important, it shouldn't be your final source of information. I mean, it's ultimately, there will be flaws in the system. But at least Google. When you become a journalist, you will discover certain things yourself. You will discover some things work for you, some things don't work for you. Each person has a different approach. For me, I find that I write my questions beforehand. I like to be prepared to that degree. I've done my research and I frame my questions. Of course, when you're in the interview, that question may change. You're listening to what the person is saying and you might have a different approach to that question. But I think what you may not need to take down, you have a great memory, I don't. You may not need to take down the questions, but what you do need to do, what cannot be compromised, is the research. You have to have your thorough research done before. And what does this research involve in organization? But suppose so-and-so, you know, actor has just signed this big film has signed a big international film. Then your research should be, who is this director that he signed with, this international film? What kind of films has the director made before? This actor, what has he done before? Why do you think he was chosen? Were there other actors who were first shortlisted for this role and he's been chosen from them? Some background information. There needs to be background information so that you can ask, you can then prepare questions based on that. unprepared interviews, the problem with unprepared interviews is they look like unprepared interviews when they come out, whether you're writing them, whether you're on TV, especially on TV because TV is instant. It's hard to correct your mistakes in TV. Once you've done it, it's there, it's shot. In print, sometimes, you know, you can go back and polish it. At least you can polish your questions, you can polish your writing. You can't polish the person's answers because you've asked a stupid question. If it's a stupid question, you've asked it and it's done, and it's going to be there. You know, the answer is going to be there, and that person would have in his mind, that person has already thought. You know, I know how, at least I know how actors think and how celebrities think. In their mind, they're like, dumb person. This person didn't even come prepared, and it really annoys people. And as it should, if you've given time to me, for me to interview you, you've taken 20 minutes of your life. You've said I'm going to give 20 minutes, and remember, everyone is busy. Not just celebrities, the whole world is busy. You're busy, but the person who's giving you time is most definitely busy. So if he's taken 20 minutes and he said, I'm going to give 20 minutes to this journalist, that's precious time of his. If you've not gone prepared, he's already insulted. That you didn't, I've taken out 20 minutes of my life, this person hasn't even bothered to prepare. And therefore, research is key. Therefore, going there prepared, going there, giving the impression that you respect this person and you respect this person's work. And therefore, you've come with a certain amount of research, with a certain amount of preparation is key. So the first thing, as far as, if you're talking about the salient features of interviewing, the first part is preparation / research. You have to go prepared. The second very, very important thing is listen. We always think that interviews are about asking questions. If you're the journalist, it's only about asking questions. It's also about listening to the answers. No, otherwise, what happens is, and if you see the best interviews, let's talk about TV. All of you watch TV, all of you watch news television, who are your favorite interviewers? Come on, journalism students, who are your favorite interviewers on television? Rajdeep. Have you all seen Karan Thapar?
Yes.
Karan Thapar does these intense interviews with politicians. Arnab Goswami. I mean, he aggressive tone. But what is key? All of these guys who are interviewing are listening to what people are saying, to the other person is saying, and they're responding to that also. So the first part was research and preparation. So you've researched, you've prepared your questions, you've gone with 5-6 questions. But if you just go with questions and are not listening to the answers, what it will become is a Q&A session. The best interviews are the ones that sound like a conversation. It is an interview, but it doesn't sound like it doesn't sound like A, B, back forth. Those are more formal. What is interesting, what makes a smooth interview, whether it's in print, whether it's in TV, is when you're able to engage your interviewee, the person you're talking to, in a manner that the person forgets that there's a camera on, or forgets that it's a formal conversation, and gets sucked into the conversation to make it like a one-on-one, where it almost seems chatty. That doesn't mean your questions become soft. That doesn't mean you only ask them soft questions and you don't ask them, hard, responsible questions. That doesn't mean that. It just means that the tone is engaging. It means that you've made them feel comfortable enough to bare their hearts, to tell you what they have to tell you. So listen. What I mean by that really key is that while you go with 5 questions, the person who's answering you also is saying things which will provoke your next question. If you only go with Q&A, you're not listening to what they're saying, you get the answers only to your 4 questions or 5 questions that you've prepared. Whereas if you're listening to what that person's saying, and here's where you have to be smart, here's where your youth and your smartness come into play. If you're young, if you're smart, if you've done your research, if you have a background, if you know that person, if you know other controversies surrounding this person, and they say something, you will be smart enough to come up with another question immediately, which you may not have necessarily prepared, because they've given you material, they've said something that sparks off the next question. And that's what makes a great interview, where your questions are coming out spontaneously. A lot of what you're doing is not only prepared, it's also you're reacting to what they say in the moment, and therefore listening is very important. It's tricky because you're paying attention to so many things. You know, you're trying to make sure you don't miss your questions, you're trying to make sure that the guest is never annoyed and never offended by your questions. At the same time, you're listening. An interviewer's job is many things rolled into one. But listening is key, because if you're not listening, you're only getting the answers to your questions. You're only, and you have to also remember that the person who's answering is very smart. Today, they're all on TV. Any celebrity, whether they're a sportsman, a politician, an actor, anyone, all of them are on TV. All of them are celebrities. All of them are used to, just as used to, you will become interviewing, they're used to being interviewed. So they're smart. They already know what they want to answer and what they don't want to answer. If you're not listening and you're not coming up with ways to counter, sometimes they'll give you, you'll ask a really important question, why did you do this? And you'll talk to a politician and say, why have you not been able to solve so and so matters? Why have these matters not been able to be addressed? They don't want to answer that question. Most people don't want to answer the hard questions. They will find a way to not answer that question. If you're not listening, you'll think, okay, I got this answer, move on to the next. You can't. You need to cross question. So your listening is also important for cross questioning. You have to be able to ask the next question so that if that first question didn't get you the answer, let me ask the next one, let me ask the third one. Sometimes you'll ask four questions to get the answer to that first question. But that cross-questioning is important, and that will only come when you're listening. Yeah? In my experience, I have realized that you can ask any question in the world, however unpleasant, however awkward it is, you can ask it. If you ask it well, if you ask it correctly, you can ask the toughest questions. And I've been in very awkward situations. I mean, you will have to ask, you know, you have to, there are times you have to ask really awkward questions. I mean, some actors had an affair, someone's had, I mean, you know, these are not questions you really want to ask. It's someone's personal life. You don't know who you're going to be working for. Today, we all would love to work for, you know, the Indian Express, which is, you know, perhaps one of the best papers. But tomorrow you may be working for Stardust. I mean, there are people who end up working, and Stardust may expect, you know, depending on who you work for, there's a certain kind of journalism that each publication does. And you have to respect them for that. If you signed up for that, you have to send it. So my point is, you may have to ask awkward questions. How do you do it? You can do it. You can ask the most awkward questions if you're not doing it in a manner that is offensive. If you're not hurting, if the intention and if your manner of asking is not in a manner that is hurting the person. Or at least, you know, it doesn't seem offensive. What that means is that if you genuinely want, it's also, interviewing is also about not showing off. Very often you find interviewers are showing off. They want to show that, look, I could ask this question. And you ask it in a rude way or in a very bold way, because you feel that I look so brave that I asked this question. Maybe that's a great approach for you. Maybe that's great to make you look good. But you've not got the answer. 9 out of 10 times, when you ask that in that manner, when you ask, you know, so, you know, Yuvraj, you played so badly. I mean, you've lost your form completely. You haven't scored at all in this series. I mean, how do you explain that? That you have shamed the nation. More than likely, the person who's being interviewed has already lost his cool. You've already offended him, and now he's not really interested in answering, because he already has realized that you have made up your mind about him already. You've judged him, you've failed him, and now he's not interested in answer. So while you may look very smart about asking that, being able to ask that question, you've not got the answer. What is the purpose of an interview? The purpose of an interview is not for you to look smart. The purpose of an interview is to get answers. And you failed the purpose of that interview because that person hasn't asked you. So the key, if your objective is to get the answer, you wouldn't ask it like that. You'd find a way to ask. Although that question particularly, I don't think is the question. I'm talking about much more personal things. I'm talking about much more intimate things, which are awkward to ask. There's a way to ask it. I think when we're talking, for example, I met a filmmaker who was shot. A lot of people may not want to talk about, you know, being shot by terror, by the underworld. And it's about how you ask it. I was surprised. I met him a couple of months ago, and I was awkward. I mean, you know, you're asking someone to reveal details which are personal, and they may be awkward to talk about. I mean, you know, being shot at, and it's something that's also very, it might be something that's you know, that's psychologically, he may not be very comfortable talking about that. But it's the way you ask it. If you ask it in a genuinely curious, you know, manner, and I said, everyone knows about that incident, but you were so brave because despite getting that, you know, two bullets in your stomach, you drove to the hospital yourself, and you managed to get yourself admitted. It's about how you ask it. And he gave me he spoke to me for 10 minutes about the whole scenario, about how he saw the guy shooting, firing bullets from behind the shotgun, but it went into the back, you know, the back headboard of the car. I mean, these are great details that I've never heard him speak about before. But it's about how you ask it. And it's funny, because I'd interviewed the same gentleman about 8 years ago about the same matter, and he didn't talk about it that time, because at some point I may have asked it in a manner that he wasn't comfortable talking about. So the point I'm trying to make is, you can ask any question, however uncomfortable, because it's your job, you may have to ask that question. If you do it in a way that doesn't offend the person and that makes the person feel comfortable enough to answer it. Another very important thing is, keep your questions short. Nobody wants to hear. When you're interviewing someone, whether it's in print, whether it's in TV, why is someone reading an interview? Why are you watching an interview? Usually it's because you're interested in the person who's being interviewed, right? It's not so much because you're interested in the interviewer. You're interested in the person who's being interviewed. Nobody wants to hear the interviewer's voice beyond the point. I want to hear the question, but I don't want, you're not the star. You're not the reason that this, you know, the person who's doing the interview is not the reason why I'm listening to it. I'm listening to it or I'm watching it because I want to hear what the other person has to say. Never forget that. You're not the star. The other person is the star. When I say star, I use that term loosely. That could be sports star, that could be politician. You're not the person being interviewed. You're doing the interview. Keep your questions brief, keep them to the point, which is why I like to go prepared with my interviews. I like to go prepared with my questions. I tend to write down, you can either take down points, there's no harm. The other thing a lot of people ask is, is it awkward when you're on TV and you have a chit of paper with notes? No, not awkward at all. In fact, it shows that you come prepared. No, never, I always have a chit of paper. You don't necessarily have to hold, I mean, you shouldn't be holding it up like this and reading it. That's just not good television. But you keep it down and you read. I do it all the time. You know, I sit and do one-on-one interviews. I always have a little chit of paper. For different people, different things work. You could be writing just points. You don't necessarily need to write the full question. You could just write keywords. That's again important in journalism fully. You don't necessarily have to write down full questions. And you're supposed to be masters of the language. If you're being a journalist, you have to be in command of the language. So you write keywords. You might write, you know, last film flop. That's all you need to write. Or, you know, the name of the film and say flop. And you frame the question when you're talking to the person. Or you might need to write full questions. I am one of those who needs to write full questions. But there are people who don't need to do that. And it's better if you don't. You know, it also looks more spontaneous if you're framing the question. No harm if you're framing the question as you go. You don't need to look so prepared. Sometimes going over prepared is a problem because it looks over prepared. The beauty of television, the beauty of interviewing is when it looks like you're naturally sort of, you know, coming up with the questions as you go. There's also a lot of cheating involved. I mean, no journalism is without cheating. And by cheating, I don't mean being, you know, not, is by cheating, I don't mean not having integrity. That is key. I'm just talking about cheating in terms of what looks good on, and especially in television. Television is all about cheating because it's a visual medium. But the point is, you can either take points or you can take down your full questions and go. But please have something ready. I mean, don't, as far as possible, avoid impromptu situations. Because impromptu always looks impromptu. You're never prepared. You're asking silly questions, and there's nothing more upsetting than watching a silly reporter. I mean, you know, you see it on channels. You see it all the time. The silly people, you know, someone who's not gone prepared will ask silly questions. Then you'll repeat the same question because you don't know what to ask next. You've not gone prepared. But having said that, it will always happen. There will always be situations where you will be told go right now and do it, and you will not be prepared. So, which is why you come to the other very important thing, read the papers. In fact, that should be the first rule of anything. As journalists, you have to know what is going on in your country, in your world, in the world really. I mean, you must, I mean, it's, you know, even before you step into class, the first rule, if you want to be a journalist, if you want to be in the mass media, is be aware of what is going on. You cannot be a journalist if you don't know what's going on in the world. Now, whether you want to be a sports journalist, whether you want to be a hardcore news journalist, whether you want to be a film journalist, you can't say, oh, I want to be a sports journalist, so I don't need to read the papers. Not true. All news is related to each other. You know, I find myself very often interviewing a filmmaker who's making a film about, say, you know, the coal scam in Bihar. But if I don't know about the coal scam in Bihar, which is real life, I mean, if I don't read the papers, I won't know beyond the point what to ask this guy. So you will find that all your news, all your information in all journalism, if you're not updated with what is going on in the world, you will not be a good journalist. So reading the papers is the first thing in the world that you should do. I mean, it's absolutely, even if it's one paper, and I'm not talking about Mumbai Mirror and Midday. I mean, Mumbai Mirror is not a bad city paper, but you should be knowing national news. You should be knowing at least your headlines. You need to be aware of what is going on. I mean, there is no replacement to that. That is absolutely key. And really, you should be watching some television. I mean, do you guys know yet whether you want to be print journalist, whether you want to be TV journalist? Do you know? Do you have a sense? Yeah? How many of you want to be print journalists and how many want to be TV? Print is... And TV? Well, irrespective of what medium you ultimately choose, it's news. And being in touch with news and watching TV is not a bad idea, because now TV has become, I mean, you get news quicker. I mean, live television is you wouldn't wait the next morning to get a break. I mean, if the shootout happens in the Connecticut school, you will be watching it immediately.